That is Tupacamon. This is Dr. Arap Moi, former president of Kenya. I just wanted to show you the culture. If you are a leader, you must have staff with you. This is the staff. This is the one Moi carried throughout his presidency. And his throne is the seat that Tupacamon sat on 320 years ago. Moi, I don't know whether you knew about Tupacamon or not, but he made one looking like that one. Okay, as he said, this is, some of this we'll discuss afterwards. I'm just introducing, Dr. Bolden told me after this there will be free discussion and then we'll go into the region proper. So, as is one whom we call in Egypt, Isis, in Kabbalah language, she's Isis. She's represented by the sun. The sun is also Isis, and that's the biggest symbol of her. In Egypt, she was also carrying the sun symbol. So Isis, and this proves to you actually that Isis, the sun, just like Ra was the sun. Okay, and they worshipped her all over in Europe and other places when the African was up. I want us to tell our children that there was a time when we spread religion all over the world. We spread ideas of rule all over the world. Let us, we as technologists, get our children to admit that and internalize that, and they'll be great, they'll return to their greatness again. That was something supported by our late friend Ivan Panisetima. So the Canadian religion has Isis as the sun as well as the God. She's, the biggest symbol of God is the sun, and the sun is named Isis, and she's she, sorry, she's she, Isis is female. Biggest god or the head god is goddess, supported by two aspects. The good, benevolent thunder, and the bad thunder. So she's in three persons. She's in three persons, but one is evil, and the other one is positive, and she's positive herself. Okay? That's how the Kalenjin account for the evil things that happen in the world, because God has some evil side in her. Okay? When the Arabs came, the Africans came, went to Arabia and also what I call colonized Arabia, they took Ilet, the name Ilet, Ilah, thunder god, and the Arabs have it now as Allah, Al-Ilah. So that is some of the things we have spread over the world. So as this is also Chivet, Egyptian, Chivet, we call it Chivet as well, and she's a sheep. And that was the name of God. This gentleman says, this is, just tell me when to stop because I was promised we can continue later. This gentleman is called Breasted, James Breasted. He started Egyptology in America. What the greatest Egyptologist in America that ever lived, and he founded the Chicago Institute for Oriental Studies. And he says, the very social, the right social and moral development of mankind in the Nile Valley, which is 3,000 years older than that of the Hebrews, 3,000 years older than that of the Hebrews, contributed essentially to the formation of the Hebrew literature, which we call the Old Testament. Our moral heritage, therefore, derives from a wider human past, enormously older than the Hebrews, and it has come to us rather through the Hebrews than from them, James Breasted himself, the greatest, most celebrated Egyptologist in America, and he did a lot of work in Egypt before he sailed back. Also, his colleague called Frankfurt. He worked with him in Chicago, but he himself was born in Netherlands. He says the people who brought the idea of rule in the world are from the south, that part of East Africa, called it East Africa, and they are the ones who brought us all this through Egypt. So in this word, support that, so like the other ones in Luo, Inca, and other East African words, which I can give you the words, Regina, Ray, Rex, Roy, Royal. So those words are from East Africa. They are also Biot. So we taught the world how to rule themselves. Now finally, how to rule us. This guy is also saying the same, that this came from Egypt. Egyptians came from the south. This is Bach, one of the greatest Egyptologists. In 1920 he wrote about it and said, this language, Egyptian language, came from, it's not Semitic at all, it came from far south of Egypt, and he described our part of Africa, East Africa, he called it the Great Lake, where people lived. They are called Punotion, and the Karen still call themselves Punotion, and the Egyptians also call themselves Punotion, although we know it erroneously as Punt or Punt. Okay, I don't want to go into language, I want us to discuss the deep language, comparative linguistics. When we come back, we will discuss comparative linguistics. You must compare to know that this language was related to this language, or is still related. You must fulfill certain conditions. You must compare words within certain domains. So like here semantic domains, like family words, mother, father, child, whatever. All these words are ancient Egyptian as well as modern Kalenji or modern Neotic. Right? And then independent pronouns, I, you, him, she, are still the same. Okay? And also genitivals, mine, yours, his, hers, are still the same. So ancient Egyptian language is not dead, it's still living. Okay? And also about the gods, Ta, Asis, Ra. Ra is the sun as well as the day. Okay? Now, the contentious thing, the most contentious thing, why people want to associate us, the black people, as the black people, the melanin of the world. I like melanin. We are the melanin of the world. Now, this thing is 4,700 years old. You can see the angles, 90 degrees. Nobody had done that at that time. The rest of the world, outside Africa, were living in caves. Just compare, they were doing this with others who are now dominating over us, were in caves. They were doing this. This is the top of the gentleman showing you here. Unfortunately, I don't know whether it's cut out. You can see the African came here. It's called Joseph. He called himself Joseph. It means the Caribbean, the ancient Egyptian, the savior. I don't know why he called himself the savior. So how did they discover that a building should stand straight 90 degrees in relation to the plane that it stands on? It's from nature. They studied that time. We are the inventors of that thing. Why a stone or a block that you use for building is square? Why are those sides square? We came up with that. But it's from nature. It means we studied nature that time. If you let water rest in a place, in a pool, it will assume a level surface. you achieve a level surface, perfect level, on its own, if it's calm. And if you threw, if you let a stone fall off, or a rock fall off from some distance up, without the disturbance of wind or anything, it will come in a straight line, pulled by gravity, but in a very straight line. And when they meet, when the two surfaces meet, they'll meet at right angles. Okay? The perfect fall and the perfect rest will meet here at 90 degrees. So they knew the most stable buildings ought to stand on the natural level, the perfect level and the perfect standing where they stand up vertical. Okay? So they came up with 90 degrees. When you're building a house, you ought to remember those degrees. But where, who invented the word 90? Why is it 90? Why not 100 degrees? Why not? Why not call a right angle 100 degrees? If it was done, if it was discovered by the Greeks, they would have used 100 because they like metric system. 100, 1,000 kilograms, 1,000 grams, 100 grams. But if you use 90 nutritions, and Herodotus, the great historian, told us nutritions are also invented geometry, so that we know that for a fact. This is how you measure, those days they measure to see that a place was level, walk this FM, and this suspended string, G string here, ended like that. Through this center place, then you'll know that the place was perfectly level. That's why they pointed out that the place was perfectly level. They use the same G to see that something was vertically correct, perfect. And they created from that stones, the huge stones that were 90 degrees on all angles. That's why that building, great building, was able to stand and it's still standing today. It looks like it was built yesterday. How they got to 90 degrees, they have 360 degrees. 360 degrees came from a mistake, an African mistake. They thought that the year had 360 days, and not 365, at first. So a full round year had 360 days. So anything full round circle has 360 degrees. So they gave us that word 360. So and the sun would go for 5 days, 90 days, you see the 90 degrees? Mm. You see 180 degrees, half the year, and then 3/4 of the year, and then finally the year. But then they discovered later that the year wasn't ending nicely at 360. Then they added 5 days. You see the 5 days they added to the year. They came up with 365 days. Our people at once came up with 365 days for the year, which was a fact anyway. That's what they, but they are the first ones to recognize it. And the five days, since they had already added the year here, officially 360 days. Now the rest of the 5 days, they said that they belong to another. They don't belong to this year, they don't belong to next year. They are holidays. Nobody works. Holidays. We just celebrate. Neither this year nor this year. It's called the 13th month. The year. The small month in cooking about. Small month. So the first day of these 5 holidays is Osiris' birthday. Birthday of the 7th. It coincides nicely with Christmas. That's what we say. Jesus Christ is Osiris. It coincides with Christmas. On the 27th day, it's the birthday of Horus or Hor. The other day, 28th, nobody does anything good because the day of Seth. Seth, the evil god, that's when he was born. The fourth day is the day Isis was born herself, and the fifth day, Nephthys, who became wife of Seth.
Okay.
Now, touching Kalenjin and things. I think we should touch this later. How Kalenjin control or keep a calendar of 120 years, periodicity of 120 years, and how it's accurate. This is something that will be important for you to know as you try to seek that pride in yourselves, and please transmit it to our children that this was ourselves. Let them have faith in themselves. Okay? What I didn't tell you about the calendar, which I'm telling you now, and then we'll tell you in detail later. We are now in the process of trying to bring them back some nationalism in them, some pride in themselves. They occupy that part of Kenya, a small part of the world. They are about 7 million, which is 0.01% of world population. That's what they are, 0.01% of world population. Yet they control 80% of all world medals in athletics from 800 to marathon. 80% in the whole world of those medals, 800 to marathon, all of them, is controlled by 0.01% of the world population. So we are telling them, it's not only your legs. That is coming from your brain, coming from your melanin. Please, you can replicate the same in other fields. So that's the campaign that I'm heading now myself. Okay, so we come back to fulfill the rest, feeling beyond the religious issues of math, because I know you love math. Thank you.
Campbell was speaking, and everybody just walked up in the middle of his talk. Like, let me get that book. He's got enough to be available for order online as well.
This question was for Professor and Dr. Eatonis. I specifically wanted to know if there's any information that we can glean from the ancient Egyptians, ancient Canadians, around how to deal with individuals who might have been corrupted by an invading force. You know, being as though we know that over centuries, there have been invading forces that had infiltrated ancient Kemet, and they were able to get up out of there and kind of reclaim control, you know, Hyksos, etc. And I just wanted to see if you could give us anything here that we could use, because we're dealing with it, of course, from the opposing forces, but also from our own, and I'm seeing more and more also from a population that is kind of becoming insane within prisons, that are coming back into our communities, and unfortunately are held as peers, peer idols to a lot of our youth. So without, we're in a situation where we can't, you know, kill these individuals, right? And at the same time, you know, a lot of us live in low-income neighborhoods, and, you know, the population is such where we have that population coming back to these neighborhoods, and, you know, our young people are engaging them, and we can't necessarily watch them all the time. So is there anything that we can do by learning from the past, basically, in action?
Thank you. I didn't get your name, though. You're the cameraman, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What can we do to defend government, to kind of pay back those people who have corrupted our lives? They have colonized us, they have enslaved us, they have taken our property, they have taken our countries. What can we do with them? I like the way you put it. How can we fight them within ourselves? How can we regain our confidence? How can we regain our position in the world? That was number one, when everybody else was still living in caves, and we're living in wonderful palaces and places like you saw, and like you always see in pictures from Egypt. How do we deal with the Persians? Those are the first people to conquer us. The Persians, there was Cambyses. Cambyses is the one who attacked us and broke our virginity forever. After Cambyses, the Greeks came, Alexander, the guy they call Alexander the Great, and pretended to chase away Cambyses, to chase away the Persians. But, okay, look at that guy there. that's October, there's a woman now. After Alexander, quote-unquote, the Greeks, he left a Greek family called Ptolemies, who sat on us. Instead of having done what they promised, which was to free us from the Persians, they sat on us instead and tried to Greekize us, to make us Greek. To convert us from our Africanness. Before the Greeks were done with us, I'm listing the people who did that to us. Before the Greeks were done with us, the Romans came, led by such people like Augustus, Octavius, who came and overthrew the half African, half Greek family of Ptolemy. You remember the famous Cleopatra? He's the guy who came and overthrew that family of Cleopatra and Antony, who were half. And it's told now Roman rule, which lasted about 800 years. This was the first guy. And he thought he was so great that he gave the month of August his own name. So we got the month of August after this guy here. Because Julius Caesar before him had given his own name to July. Not July. First of all, we thought they were so great. How do we fight them? I'm glad you said we don't kill them. We kill in ourselves. We kill that inferiority complex. As she was talking about, let us address it by learning what we are learning today. Let us see what we have contributed to the world. Let our children see it as young as they will be, the youngest. The moment they see that they can recognize a picture or anything, please let them know they were at the top when everybody else was living in caves. And show them some evidence. Do you want to see some evidence? Okay. There's a beautiful lady there. Several thousand years ago, I think you can read Dr. Bolden, how old? It's under the
Third dynasty, 1300.
Yeah, almost 3,000 years. Almost 3,000 years before Jesus. And she was wearing wigs. We invented wigs. Us. Okay? In Kenya right now, in Kenya, there is a fight. They want to remove from the courts the habit of judges wearing white wigs. They say they are wearing wigs following white colonialists. But those white colonialists were following us when they created those funny judge wigs. including the one judge. The one judge is ours, Judge Jao. Okay? And they took that from us. Okay, I just thought that lady might interest you. Okay, Tutankhamun, that's nothing to do with development. I'm just showing you that snake that's happened there, and that's happened in our part of Africa. You see, this guy is wearing the serpent, he's a king of them. All right, and this, we wrote this, we made this, I don't know how many thousand years ago. Such fine combination of lapis lazuli and gold when these people were still in caves. Show our children this. Now this you must show all your kids. You must show them. I've used my name there to demonstrate something. Okay, this is hieroglyphics, as we know, the very famous hieroglyphics. Okay? And at a later stage, hieroglyphics metamorphosized into what we call hieratics, for writing quickly. Hieroglyphics were for holy texts that were written carefully, but hieratic for quick writing. Okay? And this is where our alphabet of today, which is called Latin alphabet, came from. That one is A, it comes from this bird. The hieratic form of Egyptian is that A. And that is the A that we have down there. You see that? The moral A that we have is from our own A. In our texts as Egyptologists, white and black, we admit this, but they never let it come out.
Yeah.
They never let it come out for people to know, our own people to know that this was there, this was theirs. Okay? S. This is Sambu in hieroglyphic. S-A-M-B-U. B is a leg. This is foot, huh? And you can see the foot here. That's B. That's what gave you your B, the letter B. Okay? A, of course, I've explained to you. A. And M is from this bird. It's an owl. Egyptians. It's an M. You can see it's taken from her. Face of that bird. Yeah, that's where you get your M.
Mm.
And at the Egyptological level, white and black, I strike between the two. You can see that they borrowed all this from us. So the alphabet is created by us.
So you've been a very kind and patient audience. You can't go all night, although you'd like to. Our panelists have been very gracious with their time. Please give them one of the sides. Thank you very much.